สวัสดีครับก็ข้างๆผมคือนิกดันหลอบนะครับนิกดันหลอบเป็นช่างภาพที่ทำงานถ่ายภาพนะครับที่เกี่ยวกับเรื่องของเราเรียกว่าเป็นภาพที่ทางด้านเจอร์นาลิซึมนะฮะคือเป็นภาพที่ถ่ายกับเรื่องประกอบกับภาพข่าวหรือว่าภาพในคอนเทนต์ที่เป็นภาพคอนเทนต์จริงนะครับแล้วก็นิกเองผมรู้จักนิกมาได้หลายปีแล้วกันนิกเคยแสดงมาทำเวิร์กช็อปนะครับที่ The Jam Factory นะครับแล้วตัวเขาเข้ามาทำงานในเอเชียในยุคประมาณปี1989นะครับประมาณต้นปี90นะครับแล้วก็มีผลงานมากมายครับนิกเองก็เป็นคนหนึ่งช่างภาพคนหนึ่งซึ่งถ่ายภาพด้วยกล้องฟิล์มด้วยนะครับแล้วก็กล้องดิจิตอลด้วยนะครับก็แล้วก็มีผลงานพิมพ์หนังสือหลายเล่มนะครับจากตรงนี้ไปนะครับเดี๋ยวผมจะขออนุญาตดำเนินการพูดคุยกับนิกแล้วก็ให้นิกเล่าเรื่องงานของเขาให้ฟังเป็นภาษาอังกฤษนะครับผมจะพยายามแปลเป็นภาษาไทยให้เป็นช่วงๆนะครับแต่คงไม่ได้แปลทั้งหมดนะฮะแล้วก็ถ้าผมไม่มีอะไรสงสัยแล้วก็ถ้าผมไม่ได้เปลี่ยนแปลเป็นภาษาไทยให้ก็ถามได้นะครับผมอยากจะช่วยถามนิกให้นะครับแล้วระหว่างนี้ถ้ามีใครสงสัยอะไรก็พูดคุยกันได้นะครับ So I introduce you quickly in Thai. So you say I know Nick Dalok for quite some time. You've beenhaving the workshop at the Jam Factory a few years back. So that's where we met. And you've been working continuously as a photographer. And I think the body of your work, you should explain that yourself. I think you will do much better than a piece of paper in front of me. And that will include a lot of work that is done for magazine and a newspaper like New York Times,The Guardian, Newsweek, and many other publications that you have in book form, like The Lost Executioners, Brave New Burma, for example. So, Nick will show us some of his work, and it's always great. And along the way, we will be talking. Well, most of the time, Nick will be talking, of course. And if you need to ask him something,Just raise your hand, and we'll put you into the discussion. Is that work?
That's fine. Thank you.
We're gonna make it very casual, so it's not a lecture. Okay.
Sure.
All right, Nick. Thank you.
Thanks, Tombre. I'll begin at the beginning and just give you a broad overview of some of the work I've done over the past 20, maybe 30 years. I hope you can hear me. Okay. Amidst this din, can you hear it?
We can make it louder.
I'm used to shouting, not used to using a microphone. Okay, does that sound any better? Can you hear me? At the back, okay? Okay.
Yeah.
There you go.
Okay, so I'll just show you, we'll begin, like I say, with some images. So I've been working in the region for almost 30 years, on an assignment, but also on personal projects.That have taken me all over the place, from Papua New Guinea to India, Thailand, Sri Lanka, and so on. And covering a wide range of issues, some of which I'll go into a little bit more detail. Beginning in film, my career has traversed and moved into the digital realm, as we all have these days. So I'll talk a little bit about that as well.How that's impacted on the way people work as photographers. So this, for example, was for the South China Morning Post magazine in Hong Kong. It's about Khao San Road and the backpackers and the characters that inhabit the road. So it's a photo story comprised solely of.Portraits. And so I worked on, you know, that was for Sawadi magazine as well. Other publications include The Guardian, and this is the Telegraph magazine in London, about the civil war in Burma. And the ongoing crisis in Thailand. Well, the recent ongoing crisis. I don't know if it's still ongoing, but anyway.
I'm not quite sure we can...say much about that.
We're moving straight on.
Yeah.
So the reason I came out to Southeast Asia was it had nothing to do with photography, really. I was interested in Cambodia, and what piqued my interest was a film that came out in 1984 called The Killing Fields. And it was because of that film that that began a long interest in the country. I traveled out to Cambodia at the age of 19, straight from art school, and that's where I began to take photographs. I always had the intention of going back to art school to continue a career probably as a fine artist, but instead ended up being a photographer. And I began, after watching The Killing Fields, you know, as a teenager, I began to look at other photographers. I looked at war photography particularly. I was interested in conflict. I'd look at the work of people like Eugene Smith, who you see here. He's known as the sort of master of the photo essay. And then, of course, the work of Donald McCullen, who's a British war photographer, probably the most famous war photographer. And he did a lot of work in Vietnam during the Vietnam War. This is also Don McCullen. And of course, the work of Henri Cartier-Bresson, probably the world's most famous photojournalist. So these are a bit small because they were robbed from the internet. We'll have bigger pictures in a minute. So these are just some of the photographers that influenced me. Salgado, Sebastián Salgado, who recently had an exhibition at the BACC. Steve McCurry from National Geographic and Magnum. But probably of all the photographers that influenced me the most, it was Philip Jones Griffiths and his work in Vietnam during the Vietnam War. And in particular, it was the photographs of the wounded, innocent women, men, and children in the hospitals of Vietnam that really moved me. So those are some of the photographers that, you know, had an impact upon me. Anyway, I arrived in Cambodia at the age of 19 in 1989. To give you a sense of what it had been through under the Khmer Rouge, they'd evacuated the towns and the cities, and they tried to impose this pure agrarian utopia on the country by having a classless society made of peasants. And this is, in 1979, the Vietnamese army rolled into Phnom Penh and liberated the country from the Khmer Rouge, and this is what they found. So Phnom Penh, for over 3 years, Phnom Penh lay empty as a city. This is a photograph taken by a British photographer in 1979. A few months after the Khmer Rouge were driven from power. As we all know, the Khmer Rouge are responsible for some of the worst atrocities of the 20th century. By the end of their reign of terror, somewhere in the region of 2 million people were either dead or missing. This is one of the killing fields outside Phnom Penh, in a place called Chiang Ek. These people here were interrogated and tortured at a prison called Tul Sleng in the center of the city. This is the razor wire outside around the perimeter of the prison. This is one of the photographs taken by Vietnamese soldiers on their arrival at Tul Sleng. There were seven survivors out of about 20,000 people. The rest were murdered. And today it's a museum which you can walk around. I'm sure some of you who've been to Phnom Penh will know it. But one of the things that struck me were the photographs of the prisoners. The Khmer Rouge had photographed their prisoners on arrival at the prison, and very often they'd photograph them after they'd been executed. And I think it's these photographs, more than the skulls of the killing fields, that had a lasting impression upon me. Even babies. So I began really by accident as a photographer, and I came and based myself here in 1991, and I spent a lot of time in Cambodia during the war and during the UN peace process. So I wanted to photograph, I suppose, the effects of the war, of the conflict upon ordinary Cambodians. And wanted to see what the UN peace process was going to mean to ordinary Cambodians from the ground up. But the peace process broke down eventually, and fighting soon resumed between the government forces and the Khmer Rouge guerrillas. And it's there that I began to photograph the effects of landmines. There was somewhere in the region of 10 million landmines scattered throughout the country, enough landmines for every man, woman, and child. This young man here is 31 years old, his name is Hearn Bong, and he died shortly after this photograph was taken. And it began for me a process of really examining the problem of landmines, which was a global, or continues to be a global phenomenon. And I began to photograph every aspect of the problem in Cambodia, from the initial accidents right through to rehabilitation. And this is where the international campaign to ban landmines was born. So I produced a book called War of the Mines, which ended up was the first really detailed study of the impact of landmines on ordinary people in Cambodia. So not only the problem, but also the solution being the clearing of minefields by mine clearance agencies. And I had exhibitions, and the work traveled quite a lot. It was used quite extensively, in this case with Oxfam. But every time I went to a new part of the country, I always visit the killing fields. And I would always look for clues as to try and reach some sort of comprehension as to what occurred and why under the Khmer Rouge. This photographer, this is for an assignment for a magazine called Asia Week, which no longer exists. We went in to talk to former Khmer Rouge soldiers and killers. This woman had worked at Tuol Sleng prison, and this is in 1998. We found her and we interviewed her. At first she had admitted to killing 200 people, but the day that we met her, she denied ever killing anybody. And of course, I'd always return to Tuol Sleng prison. And it was there that I came across a photograph of the commandant of the prison, a man called Kang Kek Eof, who presided over the killing. And I felt that if you could find this one man, then maybe you'd have a key to many of the other mysteries of the Khmer Rouge, but particularly the mysteries of the killing, why they were so widespread. So I used to carry this photograph around with me towards the end of the war in Cambodia. So this is like 1997, 1998. And I'd ask former Khmer Rouge soldiers, these are Khmer Rouge here, if they'd ever seen him. And they all said they never had. This is one of the last reintegrations of Khmer Rouge soldiers into the government army. I also showed the photograph to them there. And then by accident, whilst I was on an assignment in the west of the country, I came face to face with him. And this is the very first photograph of Comrade Doik, a man who presided over so much killing, 20,000 people at least. So this is the first photograph taken by a Westerner of Comrade Doik. As a result of this discovery, I returned with another journalist and we interviewed him. And this photograph here is actually of him confessing to mass murder. It was the first time a Khmer Rouge, senior Khmer Rouge, had actually talked about the killing. And the story went viral, I suppose you would say for nowadays. But as a result of this, he was arrested, incarcerated, and he became the first Khmer Rouge to be tried at the UN-backed tribunal in Phnom Penh. But I felt that an opportunity had been lost here, because here was a man who was willing to speak. And by publishing his photograph and the contents of an interview, I'd actually inadvertently shut him up. So I began this process of trying to find out more about him and what we could learn from his story. And I went around the country and interviewed and tracked down members of his family, people who feared him, people who had worked under him or been his subordinates, to talk to them. In this case, this man here is responsible for many of the killings at Tuol Sleng. He used to admit to killing something like 1,000 people. This man here was an interrogator at the same prison. And then I found Doik's son. And here he is holding up a photograph of his father at about the same age. So what I was trying to do is to build up a portrait of a killer, to get a sense of what turns somebody, what changes somebody. And I published a book called The Lost Executioner, which was published in 2005. and it's just about to be released in Thai. I'm not sure when. I think in January. So that's one. That's basically a very quick version of why I ended up being here.
And it gives them a wrap up.
Yeah, sure.
ก็นิกได้เล่าให้ฟังเรื่องชีวิตเขานะครับว่าเขาได้เข้ามาเป็นช่างภาพได้ยังไงบ้างนะครับเริ่มจากความสนใจในวัยรุ่นตอนจากภาพยนตร์เรื่อง Killing Field นะครับทำให้เขาสนใจเรื่องของในภูมิภาคนี้นะครับโดยเฉพาะอย่างยิ่งเรื่องของประเทศกัมพูชานะครับแล้วก็ทำให้นิกเนี่ยเริ่มเข้าไปสู่เดินทางไปอยู่ประเทศกัมพูชาเพื่อจะดูว่าเขาอยากจะค้นพบว่าอะไรที่ทำให้คนเนี่ยถึงได้มีการฆ่าล้างเผ่าพันธุ์นะครับของเขมรแดงเนี่ยได้มากขนาดนั้นนะครับแล้วก็ในระหว่างที่เขาเดินทางไปเนี่ยเขาก็ได้เริ่มที่จะเรียนรู้จะถ่ายภาพแล้วก็กลายเป็นช่างภาพที่เราเรียกมันเป็นช่างภาพเหมือนกับเป็นคอยแมกนัม right
แมกนัม
yeah the way you shoot the photo ก็เป็นช่างภาพแบบเราเรียกว่าแมกนัมนะครับเป็นช่างภาพขาวแล้วก็เป็นเรื่องของภาพสงครามนะครับแล้วก็นี่ก็พยายามที่จะแสดงให้เห็นมุมมองของความเป็นจริงของสิ่งต่างๆที่เกิดขึ้นนะครับเริ่มจากการฆ่าล้างเผ่าพันธุ์ไปจนถึงเรื่องของแลนด์มายหรือทุ่นระเบิดนะครับในเขมรนะครับแล้วก็ไปจนถึงใน subject สุดท้ายที่เขาเล่าให้เราฟังเมื่อกี้ก็คือการที่เขาพยายามไปหาว่าใครที่เป็นต้นตอนะครับในการหรือการควบคุมในการประหารชีวิตคนได้เป็นพันๆหมื่นๆคนนะครับแล้วก็ทำให้เขาสนใจ subject เรื่องนั้นแล้วก็พาเขามาอยู่ที่นี่ตอนนี้นะครับโอเค so that's a very quick version of that
thanks Tom
okay
so in between going to basing myself here working in Cambodia I also began a project in Burma which again resulted in a book it was 20 years in the making And it was really to try and describe in pictures what a military dictatorship looked like, what it meant when people talked of oppression, how that translated into photographs. So, you know, for many of us, I think our understanding of Burma is between Aung San Suu Kyi versus the generals. And that was pretty much all we understood. And that's pretty much all I understood when I started out. So I began at the refugee camps of the Thai-Burmese border. And then eventually I went inside the country and I was struck by how difficult it was to see any signs of a military dictatorship. At this stage, Burma had been ruled for about 40 years by the military. And all I could sort of come away with in terms of imagery were picture postcard images of the country. Nothing that really spoke of oppression. And if you did see something, it would be fleeting, like somebody being arrested on a street corner like this. But I did manage to get access to Aung San Suu Kyi and her party, and I photographed her in a meeting. And I took a portrait of her, which ended up being used in protests all over the world and on posters. And I spent ages trying to get photographs like this, for example. This is Insane Prison. It was the largest prison in the British, built by the British during their empire when they ruled Burma, and it was built to house 2,000 people. When I photographed it here, there was somewhere in the region of 10,000 people. So you can imagine what conditions were like. In this case, this is prisoners working in a quarry in Shan State. And then, of course, images of the Civil War. And of course, you've all heard about the Rohingya. This is 10 years ago, not a new crisis. And then the refugees of the Thai-Burmese border. This is Melak camp in Dak province. So what I was trying to do with these photographs was really get a sort of a narrative, the idea of photographs almost translating into words. The more I did, tried to get photographs that spoke of what was going on in Burma, the more it seemed to elude me. And I think what interested me most towards the end was the military, and yet they were conspicuous by their absence. You never saw them. You never, very rarely saw soldiers. And yet they control the country as they do to this day. This is the closest you ever got to it, which is, this is called Armed Forces Day, and it's celebrated in Naypyidaw, the new capital. It's obviously a screen grab of a television in a restaurant. But then I was invited out of the blue to go and photograph Armed Forces Day. So the very pictures that I wanted to get, I was allowed to get. Pictures of the generals and pictures of the army. Something like 15,000 soldiers marching. But I also wanted to show, to complicate those sort of images by having images like this. These are Burmese soldiers who were captured by the Karen at a battle. Most of them were allegedly had taken part in abuses of villagers and committed rape and, you know, other atrocities. But here this photograph speaks much more to the idea of a victim rather than a perpetrator. And towards the end, after almost 20 years, as I say, photographing it, I went to the north of the country, to Kachin State, to photograph what was happening there. In this instance, a mine victim, because a ceasefire had broken down. And more than 100,000 people have now been displaced to the refugee camp. But as I say, I was trying to get these photographs that spoke, and what I ended up doing when I wanted to describe the ethnic diversity of the country is to take simple, straightforward portraits without really thinking about them. This is to reflect the kind of extraordinary diversity of Burma. And actually, it's these pictures more than any of the others that really speak to me now. They go against this idea of a monolithic identity, of a Burman identity, a Buddhist identity. So rather like the photograph of Aung San Suu Kyi that I took, I think they contain, they're ambivalent. And that, to me, in its essence, is photography at its best, is when it is ambivalent, because it reflects a sort of more a complex truth or set of truths. Rather like Aung San Suu Kyi was seen to be very much a, you know, figure, a principle. We now see her as being almost the opposite today. And I think that photograph still crosses that dividing line, if you like, between good and evil.
ในงานที่ชุดที่นิกได้ให้เราดูไปหลังสุดนะครับก็เป็นงานที่เขาเข้าไปทำงานในพม่านะครับซึ่งความตั้งใจแรกก็คือจะเข้าไปดูเรื่องของมุมมองของลักษณะของความขัดแย้งแบบที่นิก เคยทำนะครับระหว่างไม่ว่าจะเราจะบอกว่าเป็นทางด้านของทหารนะครับหรือกับองซานซูจีนะครับหรือความขัดแย้งอะไรก็ตามนะครับแต่ว่าวันนี้เข้าไปในพม่าก็ไม่ได้เจอความขัดแย้งอย่างที่ว่ามากนักนะครับโดยเฉพาะอย่างยิ่งการที่การแสดงออกถึงการที่เป็นรัฐบาลทหารพม่าเนี่ยก็ไม่ได้ถูก แสดงให้เห็นในเมืองที่เขาเข้าไปดูมากนะกันนะครับเขาพยายามจะหามุมมองที่จะถ่ายรูปทหารก็ไม่ค่อยมีนะฮะแล้วก็เขาก็ได้มีโอกาสเข้าไปถ่ายรูปทั้งทหารแล้วก็องซานซูจีนะครับแต่ว่านิกก็เดินทางต่อไปนะครับแล้วก็ได้เข้าไปคลุกคลีเข้าไปดูชีวิตของชุมชนต่างๆในพม่ามากขึ้นทั้งตอนเหนือแล้วก็ในที่สุดนิกก็ได้เรียกว่าถ่ายภาพนะครับคนพม่านะครับแล้วก็สิ่งที่เขาสนใจในโปรเจกต์นี้ก็คือการที่เขาได้สามารถที่จะถ่ายภาพหรือแคปเจอร์นะครับมุมมองของคนพม่านะครับของชาวพม่าซึ่งมีความหลากหลายมากนะครับแล้วก็เป็นภาพชุดสุดท้ายที่นิกได้เราดูไปสักครู่นี้นะครับ I did that quickly as well yeah but well I tell them about the letters of your work that you showthat you went to Burma, Myanmar, whatever, okay? And your interest actually lately fall into the interest of people and the diversity of the, you know, how people in the countries was created with diversity. So that's the end of that.
Thanks, Dongri.
Okay. You work always have, you know, you always find a very strong subject to work with. I think that's your character, and that reflects very well in the way you shoot the photo, okay? So, what do you think when you shooting? What do you think?
Well, I usually have a fairly clear idea of what it is I'm doing. So I don't, for instance, take a camera with me everywhere I go and photograph things that interest me on the street. I usually have a clear idea of a set of objectives, an idea. I do a lot of research, I do a lot of reading, I watch films, I do a lot of interviews as well. So it's not just purely about taking nice pictures, it's about understanding the subject as best you can as an outsider.
So that's can I say that's quite different for other photographers that actually work on the photography just for the picture's sake. But you're actually trying to tell the story through your work.And that's actually a lot different. Yeah? So you research into the subject before you shoot. And so can I say that the work of yours, there is no accidental. I mean, it's really a narrative work, right?
Yeah, very much so. But I wish I was a bit more looser in that way, as in just being able to respond to things as you see them. I mean, I tend to sort of try and look beyond the immediate.
Yeah.
How are we doing for time? You're okay.
Yeah. So I think that for me, that's quite different from the way that we normally know other photographers, that they pay much of the attention also in the subject, but in a very photographic way. But you actually look into more of political way and a more thesis way of the subject you want to shoot.So that's really much different.
They also tend to be really long term. So for example, if I've got a series of pictures here, so as I said, I think it was 25 years ago to the day I photographed this mine victim. I actually picked him up and took him to hospital. So he'd stepped on a landmine. And I found him 25 years exactly to the month since his accident, living in the same district in Cambodia. And actually life is really good for him.So it was also important to follow up on a more positive note. Here he is with his family, and life, you know, life is actually very good for him. Almost no landmines left in the area. So like the Burma one and the Cambodia stuff, they're not just a couple of weeks, they're months, years, sometimes decades. And then we did another story. This is a more recent assignment following on from that.So the government of Ireland wanted me to go and photograph mine clearance, which they support financially in Cambodia. So I suggested we follow one character over a period of a week, and or a little bit more, and just to give a sense of what it's like to actually work in a minefield. So here we have Srey Yen, who's only 23 years old. She was a toddler when the war ended in Cambodia, and yet there she is working in minefields.Clearing up decades of unexploded ordnance and landmines. This is a Soviet-made landmine she's working on there, which she later destroyed. So yeah, I mean, that's nowadays it's very difficult to get assignments like this. You just don't get them. They're very hard.
Mm-hmm. And I don't think, I mean, most of the people this day, I don't want to say that, you know, they work differently. I think they took the subject lightly and they don't get themselves involved very much on the subject. So that's why, you know, it's quite rare for us to see a very strong subjective portrayal through the photo this day. But that's actually a lot of contribution you have to do for your assignment.
How do you mean?
I mean, you spend a lot of time.
Yeah, I guess so.
You get paid, right?
Not very well.
That's what I'm worried about. I mean, I wouldn't do that. I mean, that's a lot of work.
Well, it's interesting.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So can you...
Please work in an office any day.
So you're not doing it for money? Oh, you do it for money, but it's not about that.
I did this one for money, yeah. I mean, you know, there has to be more to it than just simply making money. Of course, it's not, you know, everyone needs to make money, but I think it's finding the stories that people are interested in publishing or supporting in some way. That's what's the difficulty. That's the challenge nowadays. There are very few assignments now for photographers.
But even though you not actually get the assignment, you do it for yourself, like projects, you still actually submerge yourself into the subject, pretty much.
Yeah.
That's your way of your work, right?
Definitely. Yeah. So I was going to talk a little bit, I was asked to talk a little bit about film, because we've got a lot I noticed that it seems to be quite fashionable to, makes me feel really old, the fact that all these cameras are now for sale, and they really knock down prices, and they're considered to be retro. I still use these cameras quite well. So, I mean, my career has, as I say, it's sort of halfway through it. We've had to make this enormous switch. We've had this incredible revolution, the digital revolution. I'm not a purist, but I do feel much more comfortable with film. I know it better. I think it's, there are a number of reasons for that. But one of the things I think that a lot of digital photography has taken a lot of the fun out of photography in some respect is because I think the possibility of chance is taken out very often. The imperfections of film photography have been removed. So you've got perfect, you know, images very often. And you have plugins to get exactly the right effect that you want to get. There's not a great deal of creativity I see in a lot of work. This, for example, was one of these great accidents you have with film. I went up to a protest, not far from here in fact, in 2006. And all these yellow shirt protesters and this very animated guy at the very front row, and there were all these press photographers around him for obvious reasons. I mean, he was very dramatic. I hadn't got a film. I had a film camera, Leica. I hadn't got any flash. It was at night, and all I did was I opened up my camera so that it would last for, I don't know, a 15th of a second, something like that. And I had a photographer on this side and a photographer on this side, both from wire agencies, firing away with their flashes. And I didn't have one. I just took this picture. I was in between them, and I didn't know if I got anything. There's a whole roll of film wasted. There was nothing here on it except for this one image. So I thought I could get maybe something and it might be quite interesting, but I had no idea what. But it worked, I think, you know. So that's the sort of thing that makes it slightly different with digital. The room for discovering new avenues of being creative with this medium perhaps are somewhat restricted. I don't know, that's my impression anyway.
Yeah. I think that's part of the, you know, equation why film photographer is coming back. Because people actually live in a very prominent prediction world. I mean, they can predict everything with the technology. And I think the diversity from that perfection is something became more of the value. And I think the people of this generation are hungry for that. So when they took film photography for the first time, they were so surprised and they were so impressed. So that's why they mostly fall in love with that.
Yeah, I think there are lots of pluses and minuses in both directions. I'm going to show you just very quickly some photographs from a project I did with an aid organization here called Rak Thai Foundation, and it's or Care Thailand. And they were doing a lot of work, or they still do a lot of work with migrant workers here, Cambodian and Burmese mainly. We produced a book called Invisible People. Anyway, the director of Rat Thai Foundation asked me to photograph it in black and white. And I said, okay, you know, if you like me to, that's fine, no problem, but it's going to cost you probably another $1,000 on top in terms of expenses, printing, processing, and so on. And he said, well, look, could you just shoot it in digital and then convert it into, you know, desaturate it and convert it into black and white? So I did. These are the original pictures, or some of the original pictures I took of the migrant workers. These were outtakes, actually. And I'll explain in a minute. But I found a plugin, which I'm sure you're all familiar with now, where you can lay across grain to make it look as though you've used film. So you can choose the film you use, even though it's not film. And it could be, you know, Tri-X 400 or T-Max or, you know, whatever. So here we go. This is Tri-X, apparently. And this is the book that we produced in the end. These are some of the tear sheets. They're again, you know, conversion into black and white. So all these pictures here were not shot on film at all. They were shot on digital. So that's amazing, you can do that. I mean, we saved $1,000 there, you know, which is great. But it's not the same. Anyway.
I think when you're speaking of like professional photographer, that you need a result. Of course, sometimes digital produce the result, which is quite predictable, and you're not wasting your time. But when you talk about photography as a hobby, that's a big difference.
Yeah.
And I think that the new generation of people, they take a photo as a hobby. And when they do that, the film always produce a more, you know, not, I will not say fashionable way, but it's more surprising way as a hobby, you know. I tell you, my son, for example, he loved photography and he took digital, you know, for a few months. Then he turned to film and he never come back. And he always shoot film and he said digital doesn't deliver for him in terms of the surprise that he always got from the film. Now he shoots film that much better than me. And I feel actually ashamed about that. So, yeah, so I think เราก็ได้เห็นงานของ Nick นะครับแล้วก็ Nick ก็ได้ให้ดูงานช่วงท้ายซึ่ง Nick ก็ได้เล่าเรื่องของการถ่ายภาพด้วยฟิล์มนิดนึงนะครับก็นิกก็บอกว่ามันมีอยู่ภาพนึงที่นิกถ่ายตอนนิกถ่ายภาพด้วยฟิล์มมาตลอดแล้วก็ยังถ่ายอยู่นะครับแล้วก็ช่วงหลังก็ไปถ่ายเป็นดิจิตอลมากแต่ว่าในช่วงที่ประมาณนักปีอาจจะ10กว่าปีที่แล้วนะครับที่มีการประท้วงกันแล้วนิกก็ให้ดูภาพนึงนะฮะก็นิกถ่ายภาพนั้นด้วยฟิล์มนะครับแล้วก็ที่น่าสนใจคือในนั้นน่ะมืดมากนะครับในภาพนั้นน่ะมืดในเฟรมนั้นน่ะมืดทุกอย่างมืดมากแล้วก็นิกก็มีกล้องเป็นฟิล์มอยู่ตัวเดียวแต่ว่าช่างภาพอยู่ข้างๆนี่มีแฟลชนะครับนี่ก็ใช้วิธีถ่ายภาพระหว่างที่ช่างภาพข้างๆยิงแฟลชแล้วก็เปิดประมาณ15นะครับซึ่งก็ทำให้เขาก็แคปเจอร์ภาพนั้นได้นะครับแล้วก็เขาก็ถ่ายไปหลายรูปแล้วเขาบอกแต่มันก็ได้รูปที่ดีมาบางรูปนะครับสิ่งที่นิกบอกเกี่ยวกับเรื่องของฟิล์มโฟโตกราฟีก็คือว่ามันให้ผลลัพธ์ที่บางครั้งเราคาดไม่ถึงนะครับนั่นก็เป็นเสน่ห์ของฟิล์มที่ภาพแบบอื่นถ่ายไม่ได้นะครับงานในช่วงอันสุดท้ายที่นิกให้ดูเมื่อสักครู่นี้ก็จะเป็นเรื่องของงานที่เขาไปถ่ายเป็น assignment ที่ได้รับให้ไปถ่ายนะครับซึ่งนิกก็ถ่ายเป็นดิจิทัลนะครับแล้วก็คอนเวิร์ตเป็นภาพขาวดำแต่ก็พยายามจะให้มันได้เอฟเฟกต์ของฟิล์มอย่างพวก T-Max หรืออะไรนะฮะเพื่อให้มันมีเกรนหรือภาพคล้ายๆกันซึ่งนิกก็บอกว่ามันก็ดีตรงที่ว่ามันก็ช่วยให้เราประหยัดไปได้พอสมควรเหมือนกันแต่ซ้อ
Well, it's just one more thing, but does anyone have any questions, maybe? I don't know if you want to ask
them. It will be questions, I hope.
Okay, well, I'll go straight on. So now, this is a different project entirely. How do I begin this? So I think I'm moving away from photojournalism as much as I can. And I've begun a project in Ireland, which is where I was born. And it's about a 17th century battle, which my ancestors, the outcome my ancestors benefited from. And it's a battlefield called in the west of Ireland called the Battle of Ockram, and this is where I began to take photographs as a young boy, like it was about 11, 12, something like that. And part of it is, you know, it's related to my sort of interest in conflict and my horror with conflict. And this is a famous photograph from the American Civil War, which is the last time that this kind of warfare really took place. So there's a direct link between the 17th century battle and what we're seeing here with the use of muskets and bayonets and people using the landscape as forms of cover and so on. And the arrival of war photography, if you like, or conflict photography. So I remember seeing this photograph when I was very young and being really shocked by it. And to find that there was a place in Ireland where similar things had taken place, as a young boy, that was a revelation. Anyway, so I decided a few years ago to go back to this place and start photographing it try to explore photography in a very different way. Now, these photographs are not actually of Ireland. These are England, where my mother lives at the moment. And I took, this is part of the kind of research, if you like. It's part of experimenting with ideas, looking at landscape with an idea of trying to do something with it. So this is like a sketchbook before going to the final painting, if you like. I'm still in the process of sketching. So these photographs were taken, as I say, in England, with the idea of going back to this battlefield in Ireland to photograph it. So just thinking about how it may have looked on the day. In 17th century warfare, they used to use muskets, which were called matchlock muskets, which produced a huge amount of smoke. So there are accounts of this particular battle where the soldiers couldn't see one another because of the smoke being so thick. Constantly thinking of how do I portray this empty landscape where we know somewhere in the region of 6,000 people died. It's a lot of people. I mean, I even did paintings at art school on it, you know. I was experimenting with pinhole cameras, if you know what that is. And also different format cameras. In this case, it's a Hasselblad X-Pan. Well, a lot of this is a mixture of digital. So this is actually a photograph I took when I was about 11. So this is the battle site in Ireland. And that's where it all began, and this is where I'm going back to now. And I began taking photographs, these are the couple of years ago, of the battlefield today. And it hasn't changed much in 300 years. So I began by taking photographs in the summer, which is when the battle would have taken place, or did take place. I wanted to try and replicate the conditions that which the soldiers would have encountered in 1691. But I realized it wasn't really working, and I ended up going back to the exact same locations, but in the winter. It seemed to reflect much more of what it was I was interested in, or what I was trying to get to. So this is a work in progress. I hope to have an exhibition of this work in Ireland in 2020. So, there's 40,000 soldiers here. There was cavalry, there were musketeers, there were dragoons, there were grenadiers. And really, it's quite unremarkable looking countryside, which presents its own unique challenge. You know, it's how do you make something that is really quite bleak look interesting, but at the same time, retain something of that bleak nature of the landscape. And also, for me, it's fascinating to think that, cavalry would have raced down that hill towards me, And yet, very few people in Ireland actually are aware of this battle, how significant this battle actually was. So again, it's sort of a secret history, if you like. But the idea, I suppose, is to try and spark something in the imagination, to hint at things. So the complete antithesis, if you like, of photojournalism, where it relies on drama, it relies on action, it relies on a narrative of sorts. And there's an epic poem written by a poet, an Irish poet, and he talks about, musket balls being embedded in the roots of trees. So again, there's a lot of reading involved, there's a lot of research, there's a lot of reading around the subject. Irish history, Irish identity, and so on. And that's it.
I like that project. That's very elaborate. I like that. ก็จริงผมว่าโปรเจกต์นี้สนใจนะครับนี่ก็หลังจากที่ถ่ายรูปอยู่ในย่านเอเชียตะวันออกเฉียงใต้สักพักหนึ่งก็กลับไปที่ไอร์แลนด์นะครับซึ่งผมก็ไม่ได้ชำนาญเรื่องประวัติศาสตร์ของไอร์แลนด์แต่ว่านี่ก็เล่าให้ฟังว่ามีทุกอย่างในความขัดแย้งในประเทศไอร์แลนด์เนี่ยมันมีเริ่มมาจากประมาณยุคช่วงศตวรรษที่16นะครับแล้วก็มีสงครามใหญ่เกิดขึ้นนะครับนิกเองก็ผสมผสานแนวคิดของเรื่องเนื้อหาของสงครามซึ่งจริงๆแล้วก็ภาพถ่ายสงครามในไอร์แลนด์เนี่ยเป็นอันแรกๆเลยทำให้นิกเนี่ยก้าวเข้ามาสู่เรื่องความสนใจเรื่องการถ่ายภาพนะครับแล้วก็ตัวเขาเองก็มาจากที่นี่นะครับก็เขาก็เลยกลับไปที่นี่แล้วก็ไปดูเรื่องของเนื้อหาที่เกิดขึ้นในเรื่องของสงครามแต่ทางเดียวกันนิกก็เอาเรื่องของการถ่ายภาพแบบที่เรียกว่าเป็นแลนด์สเคปนะครับถ่ายราบเผื่อภูมิประเทศที่สวยงามเนี่ยเข้ามาประกอบกันผลงานของนิกในชุดนี้ก็คือสิ่งที่เขาทำก็คือว่าเอาภาพการถ่ายภาพแบบแลนด์สเคปเนี่ยแต่ว่าไปบวกเข้ากับเนื้อหาคือไปถ่ายในที่ที่มันเคยเกิดสงครามนั่นแหละนะฮะแล้วก็พยายามจะเล่าเรื่องราวของแลนด์สเคปเนี่ยโดยให้มีเนื้อหาของสงครามอยู่ในนั้นนะครับโดยที่เขาสามารถมองได้2 อย่างก็คือมองเป็นภาพแลนด์สเคปที่สวยๆก็ได้นะครับหรือว่ามองเห็นเนื้อหาของสงครามที่อยู่ในภูมิประเทศนั้นแล้วเคยเกิดขึ้นเมื่อหลายร้อยปีก่อนนะครับสิ่งที่น่าสนใจคือว่าเขาก็ได้ลองพยายามที่จะทำเรียกว่าสเกจนะฮะก็คือการไปถ่ายภาพต่างๆลองหลายๆวิธีลองหลายๆมุมมองนะครับลองด้วยเทคนิคต่างๆกล้องต่างๆการซึ่งนี่ก็เป็นกระบวนการที่น่าสนใจนะครับก็คือการเหมือนกับดีไซเนอร์คงทำสเกจก่อนเขาก็ลองถ่ายรูปแล้วก็สเกจไอเดียว่าจริงๆแล้วเขาจะทำโปรเจกต์นี้ยังไงได้บ้างนะครับแล้วก็แม้กระทั่งว่าการไปทับเขาก็รอในช่วงหน้าร้อนแล้วก็เขาก็บอกว่ามันไม่ได้เล่าเรื่องแบบที่เขาอยากจะเล่านะครับก็ต้องรอกลับไปหน้าหนาวนะฮะแล้วก็ไปถ่ายใหม่ซึ่งก็เห็นผมทำให้เห็นถึงความตั้งใจของเขาในการที่จะทำในงานในโปรเจกต์นี้นะครับแล้วผมว่าจริงๆแล้วอันนี้ก็เป็นโปรเจกต์ที่ผมชอบนะครับดูแล้วก็รู้สึกว่าก็สามารถเล่าเรื่องวิธีที่เขาเล่าเรื่องก็คือเรื่องของความโหดร้ายของสงครามความขัดแย้งซึ่งเป็น subject ใหญ่ที่นิกสนใจนะครับแต่ว่าครั้งนี้เขาเล่ามันโดยที่ไม่ได้เป็นภาพที่โหดร้ายทารุณนะฮะแต่ผ่านภาพที่เป็นภาพทัศนียภาพสวยๆนะฮะแล้วก็ยังมีความรู้สึกอันนั้นอยู่ได้นะครับ I make a compliment I think it's very genius that you actually work the way that you normally like itthrough the conflict of wars of humanity but instead of portraying the picture or the images that see the how crucial of life could be on how people being tortured like the one that you did before now this project you change the way you portray the subject through the landscape and it can be beautiful it can be crucial it can be you know, painful in a way. So this is, I think this is, I like the project so much. Yeah, it's genius.
Thank you.
Well, but that's is how you always work. You think a lot, which is very difficult for people this day to understand. ครับก็เรามีเวลาอีกนิดหน่อยนะครับถ้ามีใครอยากจะคุยกับนิกหรือถามนิกนะครับถามอะไรก็ถามได้นะครับก็ยกมือเลยนะฮะถ้าเกิดจะถามก็ไม่ต้องเกรงใจนะครับผมก็คิดว่าถ้าในวิธีที่นิกทำงานนั้นน่ะไม่ได้เป็นวิธีซึ่ง I think the way you work like I mentioned is not the way that normal people this day we work you know we know some few people in Bangkok that work like you know maybe you and Patrick but Patrick is differentBut also he actually pay a very strong attention to the subject of what he tried to shoot, and then that is I call it the resonant nature of your group of people. That's how you do the work. But I mentioned that this day, not many people think about how we shoot a photo like that anymore. Yeah, we will soon be.Obsolete, but or we come back like the film photography. We don't know. Anything you want to add to your presentation or things? Yeah.
So I just wanted to add, actually, you know, it all of this is film. None of it will be digital.
Oh wow! Finally.
Yeah. Sorry. Got to mention.
That's why it looks so good. Well, ก็มีใครจะถามอะไรกับนิกก็ยกมือถามได้เลยนะครับ Well I mean you see people this day how they work do you have any comments to that or any suggestion or advice to how they work or you want to make some comments on that
I mean I do think that not a great deal of thought is put into photography you know it's so ubiquitous it's we are saturated there are probably more photographs have been taken in the time that we've been speaking you know maybe than since photography has been around I don't know but it you know it is ubiquitous it's people take photographs of their food all the time and they publish all the time what I think is lacking is it's still there but it's very you know you have to separate I suppose the message or the signal from the noise and there's an awful lot of noise and I think what I try to do particularly with my students is try to introduce the idea of photography as a tool a photography as a way of exploring something that can you know explore not only your you know the external world but something of the internal as well and to think about things like narrative about storytelling about communicating because although I mean, everyone can relate to a photograph wherever you are in the world, but not many people spend an awful lot of time thinking about the photographs, how they work, where their limitations are, and where their power lies. And I think reflection is something that doesn't sit comfortably next to photography because it's so instantaneous, it's so quick. So yeah, and that's what I've observed, you know, lately is that people. Again, like I say, I think what is surprising about photography is how interesting it actually is when you start to pick it apart.
Maybe they shoot it too fast.
Yeah, I think that's true because you know, click and then you're done. But actually, you know, what I'm trying to do with my students, like in Mahidon or Chula, is to get them to reflect, to go back again and again and again, and say it's not good enough, not good enough, not good enough, and then you know, to not be too satisfied, too complacent.
จริงนี่ก็ให้ความเห็นเกี่ยวกับวิธีที่เราถ่ายภาพในทุกวันนี้นะครับนิกก็บอกว่าจริงๆแล้วผมว่านิกบอกคิดว่าในวันนี้วันเดียวเนี่ยเราอาจจะถ่ายภาพไปทั่วโลกเนี่ยมากกว่าภาพทั้งหมดในประวัติศาสตร์ที่เคยมีมาก็ได้นะคือเราถ่ายภาพกันเยอะมากนะครับแล้วก็ภาพถ่ายเนี่ยถูกถ่ายกันเกิดขึ้นตลอดเวลาแต่สิ่งหนึ่งซึ่งมันเกิดขึ้นในวิธีที่มันเกิดได้ง่ายนั้นก็คือเมื่อเกิดเร็วไปนะครับแล้วเราก็อาจจะไม่ค่อยได้ความสำคัญเกี่ยวกับเรื่องหรือ subject ที่เราเคยถ่ายมากนัดทำให้ภาพของเราเนี่ยมันไม่สามารถที่จะมีความลึกซึ้งนะครับในเรื่องของเนื้อหาได้นะครับนี่ก็เล่าให้ฟังว่าตอนนี้เขาก็สอนอยู่ที่มหิดลแล้วก็จุฬานะครับแล้วก็เขาก็จะมักจะไล่ให้เด็กกลับไปถ่ายใหม่นะครับแล้วก็ทำให้แน่ใจว่าไอ้การที่เขาถ่ายมาเร็วนั้นมันไม่ได้เป็นคำตอบนะฮะก็คือว่าเขาก็ต้องกลับไปดูอีกทีนึงว่าเขาสามารถจะทำให้ตัวเองเนี่ยเข้าไปลึกขึ้นในภาพหรือ subject ที่เขาสนใจได้ไหมแล้วก็กลับไปมองภาพเหล่านั้นใหม่อีกครั้งหนึ่ง you must be a very they're gonna hate you right like a teacher a student
they love me
they love you right you make them do it like again and again you know, you think that's a whole idea
no they get it they understand
they, I mean, understand.
They see the no, they see the value in it you know and I think it, try to encourage people not to be too you know to go for the 80% but actually go for 100%
100%I will make them do 200% just in case. But do you still teach at Chula and Mahidon, right?
Yeah, we did at Mahidon. Yeah, okay. this semester. Yeah.
And you still doing workshop like the one that you did in the Jam Factory a few years back?
No, not so much because I found that more of that was is more I mean, the teaching I love, but it's the marketing and all of that. That's not my strong point.
Yeah, it's say. Not. It's not our world anyway.I'm still struggle with that myself ครับก็เขายังสอนอยู่ที่มหิดลนะครับแล้วก็ถ้าใครสนใจก็คงต้องไปเรียนเขาที่โรงเรียนแล้วนะฮะเพราะว่าเมื่อก่อนเนี้ยเขาก็ทำเวิร์กช็อปอยู่บ้างครับแต่หลังๆก็เขาก็ไม่ได้ทำมากนักแล้วนะครับเพราะฉะนั้นก็คงต้องถ้าใครสนใจงานของนี้ก็คงต้องไปลงเรียนอย่างเดียว I think that if they want to learn with you now they have to take the course yeah so I think that's the deal all right so we are at 4 o'clock nowanything you want to add as your last line to this presentation?
No, just thanks very much for coming.
ก็ขอบคุณทุกท่านที่มานะครับแล้วก็ขอบคุณนิก thank you. Thank you so much. ก็ขอบคุณนิกสำหรับเวลาที่เขาให้นะครับแล้วก็สิ่งที่เขาเอางานที่เขาเอามาให้เราดูนะครับก็หว วังว่าทุกคนนะครับที่ได้ดูงานของนิกนะครับก็อาจจะเริ่มคิดงานของนิกหลายชิ้นก็ไม่ใช่งานฟิล์มนะครับแต่ว่าวิธีที่เขาถ่ายรูปเนี่ยนะเขาเริ่มมาจากฟิล์มนะครับแล้วถ้าสังเกตคาแรคเตอร์ของการถ่ายภาพแบบดิจิตอลของนิกก็ยังมีคาแรคเตอร์ของฟิล์มอยู่นะครับซึ่งอันนั้นก็เป็นเรื่องที่เราอาจจะศึกษาได้นะครับ I told them that even though the work that you show is not totally about film photography but because you start out from the film photography so even though you shoot in digital you still carry a lot of characteristicThat you develop yourself from the film photography, like the way you think a lot before you shoot. That that is very characteristic of a film photography. So I hope that they learn a lot from you today. Even though not much of the work is in film, but the way you think and the way you work developed it from the structure of film photography. So thank you very much, Nick. Thank you again.ขอบคุณทุกคนนะครับเดี๋ยวก็รอพบกับโปรแกรมต่อไปนะฮะใช่ไหมครับคุณมินครับขอบคุณมากนะครับ